My name is Michael Raeburn. I'm an independent author and design and produce books.
My name is Marilyn McCulley. I'm an art historian and a Picasso specialist. Michael Raeburn and I have been married for some 35 years. And over that time, we've lived in this house in Hammersmith. And we've collaborated over the years in many projects, especially on Picasso exhibitions and catalogs, in addition to doing research together. And that included doing the research for Michael's book on Joseph Glasgow. I was approached by someone in the art world here to ask if I would like to catalog a collection of Picassos. I didn't know who the owner of the collection was, but I met a curator of that collection and was given the material that I would be working with. And it was really an extraordinary group of Picassos, so I said yes. And I worked on that collection for 4 years before meeting the owner, and that was Stanley Seeger.
Stanley Seeger had collected a few works, a few prints by Picasso as a young man, because he began collecting when he was a student at Princeton University. But at the beginning of the 1980s, when his family firm was sold, he came into a great deal of money, and for about 10 years, he was one of the most important buyers of Picassos, and he formed this extraordinary collection.
Stanley Seeger's collection of Picassos never really was known as a collection during his lifetime. It only became known when he sold it.
He became a really close friend, and I think that great collectors, first of all, they need to have really good taste. They need to be able to distinguish what's good from what's ordinary or what's not very good. And they need to have a lot of courage to back their own judgment. And Stanley Seeger was somebody who didn't particularly want to listen to anyone else. He made up his own mind. He liked to buy direct at auction. He didn't want anyone else defining what his taste should be. And he made the most extraordinary collection. I mean, one of the great works he had was one of the big triptychs by Francis Bacon. As well as his works by Picasso, he had a lot of works by a lot of other important 20th century artists. But the artist he seems to have cared about almost most was Joseph Glasgow. He acquired his first Glasgow at the gallery where Glasgow was showing, and the owner of the gallery, Catherine Viviano, immediately telephoned Glasgow, who lived nearby, and said, I have Stanley Seeger in the gallery and he wants to buy one of your works. And Glasgow was there in 10 minutes, turned up, wasn't going to miss the opportunity. Almost the first work he bought of his was a work called Salome, which was painted in 1955 and which is probably the greatest painting that Glasgow ever made. And ever after their first meeting, they remained good friends.
Maybe the best way to describe Stanley Seeger in terms of Glasgow was that he was a great patron. He found an artist in whom he had great confidence and he loved to live with the works. When we visited Stanley Seeger's homes, we would see works by Glasgow. And I think it was that Seeger really did. He was a great patron. He looked after Glasgow in many ways and he supported him.
I think Stanley Seeger really liked Glasgow's work because it was original, it was figurative, he preferred figurative art to abstract art, and it has a kind of humanity about it, which appealed to him and which he felt sympathy for.
But he was certainly an artist who had a great reputation of in those years. And the more that I've seen works by Glasgow, especially his drawings, I think he's an artist of great quality, and I think he deserves to be rediscovered. I think it's begun. I think people are starting to rediscover Glasgow and to see his work for what it is.
He could be very difficult. He could behave very outrageously. I mean, there was one famous occasion when Stanley Seeger was giving a party for the an Italian artist who was having an opening, and he invited Glasgow, and a lot of the great and good of the New York art world were there, and Glasgow, who at that time was becoming an alcoholic, which was something he later got over, but he got very drunk and he went round and he insulted each of the curators, museum directors, personally in turn. And someone who knew him said that after that, the next day, all the museums took his work off their walls.
I think Stanley Seeger cared a lot about the legacy of Joseph Glasgow, and I think that the number of works that he acquired was remarkable. I think he acquired them out of true admiration for the art and also for the artist. I think that it's hard to say what he would see as the future, but I think he had confidence that Glasgow would eventually be recognized in the way he saw him.
He began doing abstract work when pop art and other kinds of figuration were coming back. He'd always swum against the current. And almost as soon as he died, his works disappeared. Museums which had bought his work in the 1950s and 1960s put it into storage. And Stanley felt that something needed to be done to bring back his reputation, because he was quite clear that this was one of the major American artists of his period. I got in touch with Wolfs initially because there was a painting which I found online had gone through their hands. So my first contact was through that. David Chesler was looking for someone to take over the collection that he made. Because of the book, and because we'd got on so well with David Chesler and stayed in touch with him, it was natural for him to get in touch with us and say this exhibition's coming. Since we knew about the Stanley Seeger collection, we then told Michael Wolff that he should perhaps look into the possibility of taking over the Seeger collection as well. So it happened as a kind of logical rather than a random series of events. It's very exciting that those two collections can be put together. I mean, the fact is that it's been almost impossible for people to see Glasgow's in the flesh unless they happen to meet one of the collectors, because virtually none of the museums have the works out on show, and many of the collectors, his early collectors, gave their works to museums who now have them in storage, so that actually to see a representative selection of Glasgow's has been impossible for the last 30 years.
It'll be interesting to see what kind of an impact the show has and what kind of interest is stimulated by it. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you here to Wolf's Gallery. My name is Maxwell Wolf. We're really happy to have you here on this very special evening. As you know, we have two renowned scholars here with us tonight from Great Britain. And also on my left, David Chesler, the great Glasgow collector, a dear friend of the artist, and someone who brought Glasgow here in 1973 to Cleveland. Tonight we felt it would be appropriate to have such renowned scholars be introduced by another renowned scholar and dear friend of our family, Dr. Jennifer Niles. After 37 years and 14 books on Greek art, Jennifer has just retired and accepted the most prestigious position in her field. Dr. Niles has been appointed the first woman director of the American School in Athens and will sadly be leaving us tomorrow.
He simply called it figure. But I noticed immediately that this standing figure with his arms tied behind his back was Odysseus tied to the mast. It's a wonderful print, and I think it in some ways captures the perhaps the ups and downs of Glasgow's life, the siren calls and the being bound and not being able to express yourself the way you might want to. And many of these reclining figures, of course, to me, come right off the pediments of the Parthenon. But I'm not going to talk about that because we have the two experts here, and they're going to tell us about these wonderful paintings and, I might add, sculptures.
He is, in my mind, one of the really great draftsmen of the second half of the 20th century.
Stanley didn't just collect anything. He had very specific things he wanted to collect. He collected manuscripts, he collected Gauguin woodcuts. But when it came to contemporary art, he was particularly interested in, I would think more than anything, two artists, Picasso and Glasgow.
No one could, beat him at talking about anything. He was an elevated person, sort of, in my mind, royalty and celebrity royalty, smart celebrity royalty, not.
I think it's interesting you say that because in the interviews that I attended that Michael was conducting with friends but also collectors and other patrons, many people said exactly what you just said, that when he talked about art and when it came to his taste, it was on a very high level.
Very high level.
Unless you happen to have gone to a collector who owns Glasgow's, it's been virtually impossible to see them, and that means that it's hard for people to know what they look like. I mean, it's what one hoped could happen as a result of the book. The idea of the book was to make sure that Glasgow simply didn't get completely forgotten. I mean, when we've been around museum stores and curators have taken us down into a storage and they'd never looked at the works before and they would say, that's really good, people would like that. And that's something which, you know, is what we want. That's it.